In this lesson, we're talking about the communication process and other important terms related to it. Effective communication is often called a soft skill, but I would argue that it's probably the most important skill you can have. It's important to all jobs. You can improve it with practice. So if you feel like, I just absolutely hate giving speeches or presentations, then this class is for you and it's meant to help you because you can improve oral communication skills with practice. Speaking of practice, you need to practice your speeches before you give them, whether it's for this class or any kind of professional presentation you've got to give. You need to practice them out loud and you need to time them if there's a time limit that you're expected to stay within. I know I had a student one year who lived 20 miles away. So his commute was a rather long one every day. And every day on his way in, he practiced his speech in his car. The problem is when he gave his speech on the day that he was assigned to, his speech took 20 minutes, which is a problem because the maximum time limit for his speech was 7. So he had a number of points deducted for that. And so when we talked about how he practiced outside of class, that's when he said, I practiced every day on my way to school. And I said, dude, you live 20 minutes away. That's why your speech took 20 minutes. And he's like, oh, wow, who would have ever thought, right? The other thing is, if you are a winger, if you're great at winging it, don't do that for this class, because you need to get accustomed to the discomfort that practice causes and creates for you. We kind of learn from discomfort in terms of oral communication. So winging it isn't always professional. It does always come across as winging. Obviously, if you know a lot about your topic, then that's helpful, but it still shows that you're winging it when you're in this class. Oral communication skills also help you work in and lead groups, helps you learn and adapt easier, and it shows you how to appreciate cultural diversity. Oral communication skills also help you in your reading, writing, listening, as well as your speaking skills. So think about this. Why do these career roles need good communication skills? Doctor, vet, teacher, spouse, student, significant other, fast food worker, police officer, military personnel, store clerk, and utility department laborer. So this question will probably show up in your discussion board. Here's a term that you need to know. Communication is any process in which people generate meanings within and across context, cultures, channels, and media. So yes, in this class, oral communication means talking, but there are lots of other aspects that lead into talking, like the words that we say. Where do they come from? What do they mean? They mean different things in different cultures. They mean different things when we say them in different channels. And they can mean different things in different media outlets as well. So communication is any process in which people generate meanings within and across context, cultures, channels, and media. This is the model of communication. You notice that on each side, there is a speaker on the left and the right, and they send a message. The noise is in the middle that becomes either the message or the feedback. So let's talk about how this works. Let's start with the left. So this speaker says, hello, how are you? That is the message or the noise. So the person on the right hears that message and they process it and they go, oh, I just got a message that says, hi, how are you? And so they turn around then and send a message back that's fine, how are you? And the same process happens again. The message goes back, it becomes the noise. the noise that the person on the left hears and processes to see that a response has been given to the initial message, and now this cycle of communication develops. Now, where it goes from there, it could be, hi, how are you? Fine, how are you? I'm doing pretty good. You know, I broke my foot yesterday. Oh no, that's too bad. So you see that this back and forth could go a lot of different ways at that point. But this is the model of communication that shows that each person is both the sender and the receiver. They send a message, the other person receives it. Then that receiver sends a message to make the first sender the receiver. Which just demonstrates that communication is actually a transaction. Participation in communication is continuous and simultaneous, as in that model. The sender sends a message and then the listener hears it and sends one back, which means that the first sender becomes a listener. All communications have a past, present, and a future. As soon as two people walk up to each other, the minute that someone starts to say something, then that communication has a future. So if I walk up to you and haven't said anything yet, but I open my mouth and say, hi, how's it going? I have asked you a question that is asking you to give me an answer. I've created a future in this conversation. And as you are hearing it, you are in the present of that message. As soon as I've said it, it's part of my past. It's part of your present because you're hearing it. So as you formulate your answer to me and you share that, then you are sharing a future message that becomes present as I hear it. And then the minute we walk away, it's all in the past. So communications definitely have a past, present, and a future. These things happen so intuitively for us that we don't stop and think about those things all the time. If we did, we'd probably never have time to say anything to each other. All communicators play roles in this model. Even if you're not responding, if you're sitting in a classroom and you're listening to an instructor, you still have a role to play. You're playing the role of listener. You are the message receiver in that regard. Communication also involves symbols. Symbols can be verbal, they can be tangible or concrete, they can be abstract or conceptual, and they can also be nonverbal, which is why the little emoji with the eye roll is here. It's one of my favorite nonverbal skills. So the internet creates kind of a different model of communication, but technically it's all still the same. I mean, we still have senders and receivers. We still have messages that get heard and sent back. It's just that they're a little different. So we have synchronous communication and asynchronous communication that are made possible by the internet. So asynchronous communication is actually how you're participating in this class. You're participating when you have time on your schedule, you sit down, you view these notes, and then you take your test and do your assignments. That's asynchronous. When you're not exactly face-to-face, we're not logged on at the same time. An example of a synchronous class on the internet would be when we are all logged into Zoom at the same time. You're there live, you're participating live, but you're not really in the same room together. You're at the same place because of the internet, but you are not in the same room together. And also the internet can offer the removal of face-to-face communication, although 2020 changed that for a lot of different aspects. I think now we have more face-to-face communication on the internet than ever before. We have the option for this kind of communication, which is asynchronous, but you can still see me. So you see my face, you know I'm talking to you, but it's just not at the same time. You know, you can't just talk right back. You also have things like FaceTime, you have Skype, you have Zoom. So the idea that the internet removes face-to-face communication is a little outdated at this particular point. Intrapersonal communication means communication that's done within or on the inside. So it's that little voice that you hear that, you know, maybe you're talking to yourself, or it's the thoughts that you have. And this infographic shows all of the things that work together that impact our intrapersonal communication. One of those is your self-concept, your beliefs, your value system, and your attitudes. Also, your expectations. What do you expect out of your life? What do you expect for your future? What do you expect from others? And also your perception. Perception is sometimes focused outwards, but we also perceive things about ourselves as well. So intra means on the inside or within. Let's take a look at this short example.
Ah, the last peanut, overflowing with the oil and salt of its departed brothers. Uh-oh, something's wrong.
Ow, pointy!
Ew, slimy. Uh-oh,
moving!
Uh-huh! Aw, $20. I wanted a peanut.
$20 can buy many peanuts.
Explain how.
Money can be exchanged for goods and services.
Okay, so you can see how that is an example of intrapersonal communication. So when Homer is talking, he's alone in that room, but he's saying things out loud. He's the only one hearing them. So technically, that's intrapersonal communication. But the real example of intrapersonal communication there is when he's thinking to himself. So I wanted to show you that and to point out the difference there. Intercultural communication is culture that occurs whenever two or more people from different cultures interact. Snoop Dogg is one of the world's best communicators, in my humble opinion. He reinvents himself as needed, and he is always able to cross cultures. He has a successful rap career. He has a successful career in collaboration with a show with Martha Stewart. And he had this television show from the past as well.
You thought that was dope, but MTV wasn't stupid. Cause man, that TV show was straight stupid. No one wants to see it, that's realer than real. Man, people want to see something that they can feel. I'm telling you what's up, cause I know the deal. Now sit your ass down and witness mass appeal. Don't change the diesel, turn it up a little. This is the bizzle, Snoopy Deagle double jizzle. Yeah, it's off the hizzle, for shizzle, for rizzle. This is the show we call Doggy Fizzle.
Okay, so while I'm finding the spot here, I just want to point out that Snoop Dogg creates his own language, gets people to buy into that language, and it becomes popular. What I want to show you now is his attempt at intercultural communication.
For the young people, but I'm going to show love to the old school today. Go get some wisdom for some old folks. Check this out.
How you doing, baby?
Hi.
Hey, 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 mama, hey.
Oh, boy.
Fasten your seatbelts and screw your wigs on tight. The fantastic voyage is about to begin.
You party people want to go to a church?
No!
Will you party people want to go to a club?
Yeah!
I am a bond tight, not my flame. Gotta call my name and it is my fame. It's all good, good.
Come on, y'all, let's go get something to eat.
Y'all got some gin to go with this?
Yeah, harina.
Muy bonita.
Ooh. I don't like any more that. What is that? Prune juice. You bad, bad, bad boy.
Let's go to the dance floor.
Hey, yo, I heard you elderly people had to hook.
got glaucoma, make some noise.
Yeah! Here's an oldie but goodie. Yeah, if you want to buy something good, mama gonna get you. Ooh.
You might just need some patient lift-off chairs, or maybe some vascular support, or perhaps some incontinence.
Tuckered up now. Good night, everyone. Good night, sweetheart. It's time to go. Do, 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 do.
So I'll stop it there. But it's always fun to see Snoop Dogg, someone from a younger generation, interacting with an older generation. He takes them into his culture, the club, that sort of thing. And then he goes into their culture, buying adult diapers for them, and then singing this nice old-fashioned lullaby at the end. Communication competence is the ability to communicate in a personally effective and socially appropriate manner. And to do that, you need to have knowledge, skill, and motivation. Let's take a look at this clip.
Have you considered improving your socialization skills, thus allowing you to communicate more effectively with other people?
Isn't that their burden? I'm the one with something interesting to say.
So, you can see that, right? So the idea of becoming more knowledgeable about how to increase your competency will help you also improve your skill. But you got to have the motivation to want to. In this clip, Sheldon clearly did not have that motivation. And in this class, we'll work on those things, knowledge, skill, and motivation to improve communication competency. So the five elements that you need in order to have communication competency is respect, empathy, tolerance, flexibility, and interaction management. Strategic flexibility is expanding your communication repertoire to enable you to use the best skill or behavior that's possible for a particular situation. And these are the steps you need for strategic flexibility. You need to be able to anticipate, assess, evaluate, select, apply, reassess and evaluate. And this is really kind of a creative process. So let's look at this really bad example of strategic flexibility. One day in my previous career as a reporter, I had to attend and report about a political rally. My best friend had plans that night. She wanted to come down. She wanted us to go do something fun together, but I had to go to work first. So she went with me. No worries. I mean, that's something that we did pretty regularly. It was a public event after all, so she was allowed to go too. So we were sitting at this public event. A politician takes the stage to speak. His name was one that isn't necessarily associated with a manly name, not a very masculine name. And my friend looks at me and says, his mother must have hated him. No mother would name their son that. And she laughed. Well, I kind of chuckled. And that's all she needed to continue. I mean, that was her motivation to keep going with this thing. So then she says, I mean, really, seriously, who names their kid that? It's like you want your kid to be beaten up at the ballpark, you know? Anyway, so when this politician starts speaking and he introduces his family, who is there in the audience, his mother, who named him, and his wife who married him, sitting right across from us. Well, I didn't know what to do. My friend just didn't do anything. She really didn't have the strategic flexibility in order to handle the situation. And at that particular point, the best option was for her to just keep quiet. At that particular moment, without having these skills, you know, that was really all she could do. In a better situation, what would have happened is that she would have anticipated, hey, I don't know any of these people. I'm in a town completely different from the one that I live in. So since I don't know anyone, I should assess the possibility of what might happen if I said something like this out loud. Maybe there are people nearby who know this man. Maybe there are people nearby who love this man. Perhaps I shouldn't say that. I should select comments that I'm going to say. Like maybe I should tell my friend, remind me to tell you something when we get to the car. And then I should apply that so that I wouldn't say that. Obviously, my friend didn't do any of those things. But I call it, it's really about getting your foot out of your mouth when you put it in there. So if you can anticipate, if you can look, what could go wrong with this comment before I say it? And if you could think about the situation that might arise from that, assess the pros and cons of it. Is it really something that you need to say right then at that very moment? Is it something that can wait? Make that evaluation and pick your decision and then reassess and reevaluate as needed. In terms of ethical communications, we're talking about communication that is honest, fair, and considerate of others' rights. All your communication in this class should be ethical communication. Principles of ethical communication include to protect freedom of expression, to understand and respect others' communications, to promote communication climates of caring and understanding, and also to condemn any kind of communication that degrades individuals or humanity. You should be able to express your personal convictions. You also need to accept responsibility for the consequences of your own communication, and you should always avoid plagiarism, which I promise you that we will talk about in this class this semester. Now, as far as being able to express your personal convictions, usually I run into a student in oral comm who will say, you give us so many limitations. How can I say what I really believe if you won't let me, say it? You have all these restrictions, and then that's not freedom of speech. Well, okay. So there's this whole thing about freedom of speech. I mean, you cannot run into a crowded theater and yell fire. I mean, that's a classic example because you run the risk of hurting people in doing that. People can get trampled. You are falsely communicating at that point, obviously. But as far as your personal convictions go, you need to be mindful of others' personal convictions as well. And you need to communicate professionally. When you do that, you bring about a chance for dialogue. It's like real meaningful dialogue where people can talk about hard things and people can learn from each other. It's a great opportunity for intercultural communication to grow when you can have these tough discussions with your personal convictions that are also fact-based. It's when people start sharing opinions that aren't fact-based that we seem to have problems in class. But I don't expect any problems like that from you guys this semester. Okay, that wraps up our slide presentation for just this basic introduction into communication. If you have any questions, please let me know.